Hello guys, today we are going to discuss about reflections in signal integrity. Reflections. So what is reflection? How reflection occurs? And what are the techniques to minimize reflection? This is the agenda for today's session. So we will discuss about what is reflection. What is reflection? So whenever there is a transmitter, we are having a channel, we are having a receiver. So signal travels from transmitter to the channel and channel to the receiver. Correct. So whenever there is an impedance mismatch between the driver, we call it as driver. Transmitter is known as driver. Driver impedance is not equal to the transmission line impedance. Reflection occurs. Let us take an example of it. So in channel, there are multiple aspects like transmission line, vias, and all these things create discontinuities. And this, because of this discontinuity, some part of the signal reflects back to the transmitter. And this will cause your signal overshoot and undershoot. So this is an ideal signal, this is a non-ideal signal. Now we are going to take an example of how the reflection looks like. So this is an example of reflection. I'm having a transmission line of 50 ohm impedance. 25 ohm is the driver's impedance that I'm having. So there is an impedance mismatch between 25 and 50. Both are not equal. And because of impedance mismatch, because of this impedance mismatch, reflection occurs. And the amount of signal get reflects is defined in the form of reflection coefficient. Reflection coefficient. So there are certain values for reflection coefficient that defines how my signal will behave when there is an impedance mismatch or there is a reflection there. So the formula for reflection coefficient is, for example, if I am calculating the reflection coefficient at the transmitter side. So transmitter side, rho of d equal to rd, that is the driver impedance, minus z0. Z0 is 50 ohms, that is the transmission line difference, upon rd plus z0. So in this given example, we are having 25 minus 50 upon 25 plus 50. So it becomes 25 by 75. So it becomes 1 by 3 equal to 0.33. That too, it is in minus. It's a negative value. So the value of rho, that is reflection coefficient, will always be between minus 1 and 1. So there are certain conditions that we are going to see now when the value of reflection coefficients are different. For example, if I am checking the value of reflection coefficient, if the value of reflection coefficient is minus 1, what does that mean? If the value of reflection coefficient is 1 and if the value of reflection coefficient is 0. So as we know, the formula for rho is r minus z0 upon r plus z0. This is what the formula for reflection coefficient. Reflection coefficient. So when the value of reflection coefficient is minus 1, it directly shows the circuit is short circuit. That means the value of RL equal to 0. And when rho equal to 1, that means it's an open circuit. That means RL is infinite or an undetermined value. And when rho equal to 0, that means no reflection. That means we have R equal to Z naught, and that is an ideal condition for us. So now we know what is reflection and how it occurs. Now we know how reflection occurs. Now we will focus on the techniques to reduce reflections. So there are multiple techniques to reduce reflections. Number one is by adding termination, even though terminations are of multiple types. First is series termination, second is parallel termination, third is Thevenin's termination, and one more is the diode termination. And the second part is using different topologies. So we are going to see both of these things in tools. So first of all, we'll discuss about series termination. Series termination. So how to use series termination and why we are using series termination? So as I can put up an example where I'm having a transmitter with RD equal to 23 ohms and I'm having a transmission line with Z naught equal to 50 ohms. So as we know, what is reflection coefficient for this? 23 minus 50 by 23 plus 50. That makes it 27 by 73, correct? That too in negative. Now, what happens? What if I add a series termination resistor here near to the transmitter, and that too a value of 27 ohms? How it becomes? It will add on to this one, and 23 plus 27 is equal to 50. So, rho d becomes 50 minus 50 by 50 plus 50, that makes it 0. Then if rho d is 0, that means it's a perfect line with no reflections. So the conclusion is, you can use a series termination resistor at the transmitter end. This is one of the solutions of series termination. Pros and cons. So the first pro is low power dissipation. Good noise reduction, it's low cost, and in case of complex PCBs, it is space saving. Now we will discuss about the cons. The first and foremost con is it reduces the rise time. And additional time delays. Number two, defining resistor value is not easy. We cannot use series termination in case of a long daisy chain topologies. Can't be used in long daisy chain topologies. Now let us see an example of series termination where different values of resistors are taken in the series termination, and Let me show you how the waveform looks like. Look at the figure. So RS, if I am taking RS, that is the series termination resistor as 47 ohm, I am getting this blue one. If I am using it 33 ohms, then 22, 10. We are just keeping different values of series termination resistors and we are checking the results there. Series termination resistors. Even though we are going to see all these things in the tool itself, I'll explain you using a tool, Hyperlinks SI tool. Now we will move on to the parallel termination part. Parallel termination. So parallel termination is always taken care at the receiver end. Receiver end. And we do series termination at the transmitter end. So in case of a parallel termination, let me show you an example where the parallel termination is done. Look at this figure. In this figure, at the receiver end, let me explain you this thing. So they have used a pull-up resistor here or a pull-down resistor RP. So RP is the parallel resistor here, and Z0 is the transmission line impedance. So we are using this at the receiver end. So this parallel termination is mainly used in case of DDRs or in case of parallel interfaces. Now let us see the pros and cons of parallel termination. Number one, there is no delay. As in series termination, we were seeing some delay there. And the rise time of the signal was also getting more, but here there is no delay, there is no change in the rise time. Number two, it's a low cost initiative or a cost saving initiative. It is very useful for distributive loads. And by distributive loads, I mean if I am having a daisy chain topology. In case of a daisy chain topology, I can use this part. Parallel termination is always recommended in case of DDRs. And there is only one con for this one. It is there is more power dissipation. More power dissipation will be there in case of parallel termination. Now we'll look on to the Thevenin's termination. Thevenin's termination. How does a Thevenin's termination look like? Let me show you an example where we have used Thevenin's termination at the receiver end. So Thevenin's termination is also used at the receiver end. So this is the fine example of Thevenin's termination where RTH is the Thevenin's high resistor. And RTL is Thevenin's low resistor. It's a voltage divider bias circuit in which we have to make the value equivalent to Z0 so that RTH into RTL should by RTL, RTH plus RTL. This value should be equal to Z0. Let us see the pros and cons of Thevenin's termination. So here are the pros and cons of Thevenin's termination. So first of all, there is no delay. Second point, there is a good reflection attenuation. As there is a voltage divider by a circuit use, so level adaptation is also possible with this. So the third point is level adaptation is possible. And what are the cons for this? First con is it takes more space. as we are using two resistors instead of one in parallel as well as in series terminations, we have used only one resistor. But in case of Thevenin's, we need two, so there will be more space. So in case of a complex circuit, we don't use this one. And second thing, it will not be a low cost initiative. As the number of resistor increases, the BOM will also increases. So it's a high cost initiative, and there will be additional power dissipation. So this is all about Thevenin's termination. Now we'll look into the diode termination. So let us see the diode termination. This termination is also done at the receiver end. Let me show you an example of how the diode termination looks like. So this is how a diode termination looks like. We are having Z0 as transmission line impedance. And instead of using two resistors as we saw in the Thevenin's termination, we are using clamping diodes instead of that. So how the waveform looks like, I'll tell you. So this is what I'm giving overshoot and undershoot. So after using the clamping diodes, what it does, it clamps this part. As you can see here, so this part and this part are getting clamped and the output will look like this. Diode termination is the least used termination techniques that we see. Let us see the pros and cons of diode termination. Pros and cons. Number one, there is no additional power dissipation. Why I am saying this? Because if in case of Thevenin's termination we were using resistors and there will be a potential drop across the resistors and there is a power dissipation there, but in case of clamping diode it is nothing like that. The placement of clamping diode placement is quite easy, we can say. So the first con will be the switching time of the diode should meet the rise time or fall time of the signal. So this makes it more critical, as the switching time of the diode should be equal to the rise time and fall time of the signal. So in that case it becomes very difficult to find that particular part in the market. So it says switching time of the diode should be equal to TR or TF. So that's all for the reflection as well as the termination techniques.